हेलो फ्रेंड्स, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वेलकम फ्रॉम बिरला म्यूचुअल फंड इनटू एमएफडी आज सीरीज योर मार्केट नेविगेटर सीरीज. एंड टुडे वी आर विद अस मिस्टर धवल गाला एंड मिस्टर अमित ठक्कर. इफ आई हैड गेट अपॉर्चुनिटी टू जस्ट इंट्रोड्यूस हिम, अमित ठक्कर इज अ बाय प्रोफेशन इज अ सीएफए, आल्सो इज अ चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट, एंड ही हैज बीन देयर इन दिस इंडस्ट्री फ्रॉम लास्ट 16 इयर्स. एंड द गुड पार्ट ऑफ हिम इज दैट ही इज आल्सो एस्टूट इक्विटी इन्वेस्टर. सो बीइंग अ प्रोफेशनल एक्सपर्ट, ही आल्सो आइडेंटिफाइज स्टॉक्स एंड सेक्टर मच अहेड ऑफ द मार्केट विद इन हिज ओन पोर्टफोलियो. And he is known for his client centricity, specifically when it comes to his conviction on equity and confidence. Whenever we meet as an AMC, he always prefer that in India equity is underpenetrated. So he advocates equity to his clients. And the good part is, if you just go to his site, that many clients has just given credential to him for creating wealth with Amit Bhai. So again, welcome Amit Bhai to our series. And at the same time, many of us also know our Dhaval Gala. Dhaval Gala has got 15 years of experience. And if I talk about his Birla experience, he has got 11 years of experience. Apart from he's having a 15 year of experience in the market and equity, he is known for his candid view. If I just personally talk about him, he is always known for his candid view. And I think when the BJP government came with the majority, he was the first one. Like Birla is known for identifying theme at the right time, and as a proxy to economy, banking will perform better. So he advocates that this is the right time to come up with the banking. And the good part is that since we launched, I think it has doubled almost in just 2.5 years. So that the expertise of Dhaval Bhai. Dhaval Bhai has been closely tracking the banking sector. And Dhaval Bhai, I think good that we have discussion with you today, because the way right now the BFSI has expanded, right now a lot of fintech company other than mutual fund company, insurance companies are coming. So I just we just want to have healthy interaction. And why we keep this series, your Market Navigator series, MMD asks, and our expert advisor asks, on behalf of all the partners, candid, rather heart-to-heart discussion with the experts, and at the same time, our advisor, key advisor, who asks question on behalf of the partners. So over to Amit Bhai and Dhaval Bhai.
Hello, friends. So it's really an honor to have a discussion with Dhaval Ji and all the dignitaries of the company. My first interaction with Dhaval sir was in 2013, I perfectly remember. And that too, the same day, must be the December, maybe 13, 14, 15, I do not remember that specifically.
It was November.
It was November. Oh.
November 2013, I think at Surat. Yeah.
Surat.
Early morning breakfast.
Early morning breakfast, fine. So this is your sharpness, which we always, we always give, immense respect to you, sir. So that time I first met him very young, must be 20, 23 years younger to me. But age is also only a figure, So despite his age, the wisdom which he was sharing was really great. There is one Chinese saying, a tragedy of wisdom is that it only comes when youth has gone. I think if there is any exception to this, then I think Dhaval is a perfect fit case for that. Now, I believed in his every theory, his every thesis, and I was the initial investor in that banking and finance fund at that point of time. Myself is still going on. And we have built up a friendship, and banking is always at core of my heart. I believe in banking. But then also, considering current situation, we have some questions in our mind. And so I'll start asking some few questions to Dhaval Ji one by one. I've written the questions. Generally, I like to say anything impromptu, but this time I've written it because, it's a national level webinar. So across the globe, banks are being fundamentally challenged to keep in today's increasingly innovation and disruption-driven market. In this era of fintechs and buy now, pay later driven markets, most traditional financial companies across the globe have underperformed the market quite significantly. And even the investors want more PayPal and Square type of fintech exposure rather than American Express, JP Morgan type of traditional financial exposure. Do you think India will likely to see the same fate over the next few years or so?
So, Amit bhai, very thank. I mean, I'm fairly appreciate the warm introduction you make, and definitely overwhelmed by the thoughts of wisdom you think about us. So, fairly thankful to you and Mickey for this occasion and doing a webinar. First of all, to talk about BFSI. See, there is a very material difference one has to consider the India BFSI sector and say US or Europe or Australia BFSI sector, where most of these companies you named, whether it is Square, Afterpay, PayPal, or such organizations have flourished massively. And unlike MasterCard and Visa alone, though MasterCard and Visa are still in the top 10 market cap companies globally, especially in US, top 10 companies of the world from a market cap point of view. But just to understand, India still is reeling under a significant underpenetration across all products. Whereas US and Europe, there is no much underpenetration, not such big material market size as such. So India will always be a very different market compared to these. And we would have a very different set of winners also when it comes to looking at this market and also how India is going to say metamorphize or how India is going to see the new changes which could happen. The good part is from a technology point of view, we are well ahead or similar footing when it comes to most of the Western markets. We have all the players from the fintech, from the BNPL or from any technology point of view ahead or similar than most of the Western country banks or financial services organization. If you have to compare JP Morgan, Citi, BofA, Bank of America, Merrill Lynch, or Goldman Sachs, most of these US long only, the long big banks, as well as the investment banking companies, and you compare Indian big banks, whether it is HDFC Bank, State Bank, ICICI Bank or Axis Bank, you would have technology space in India is actually better footing than most of these banks. The adoption to new technology, adoption to digital digitization of business, not just to give digital strategies to the customer, but even digitizing your own operations has been ahead of the curve. So we, in that sense, have been more frugal and more, I would say, faster in adopting this change. That's point number one. Point number two, if I have to make a thought process, is what happened with US and what happens with India is going to be materially different. US has been a developed market for ages and credit penetrations have been fairly high. First, I'll talk about credit and then maybe I can speak about more of the other financial services products, whether it is insurance, mutual fund, wealth, and the BNPL products as such. So in India still today, if one has to look at credit, penetration is really low compared to what we talk about when we compare the Western countries. You look at personal loan category, you look at home loan as a category, you look at any category within the retail or stroke personal loan category, we are at abysmally low compared to most of these Western markets. The bigger important point one needs to note is our per capita income is still at $2,000, whereas things still are far-fetched when you consider the basically most of these markets are very well penetrated, the global markets. And if one has to consider, if I have to look at history, and let's take example of US alone, or let's take example of JP Morgan or Western based good financial services companies of past. The moment you will move from $2,000 to $4,000, there would be a humongous flux of growth when it comes to financial services penetration in the country. So therefore, means whether it is a loan, personal loan product, including mortgages and retail consumption loans, whether it is insurance penetration, whether it is mutual fund penetration, and whether it is any sort of consumption type of loans, whether it happens through fintech, BNPL, or any other instrument, I am saying we would see a big big growth when it comes to improvement from of per capita income from $2,000 to $4,000 over a period of next 7-8 years. So our first big call is that this is happening. Now, important to note is you are in a market which is means if I have to understand Amit by yourself, you are in market like Surat. We stay in Mumbai, and a material portion of AMC industry AUM comes from Mumbai and Delhi, or two big cities of the country. So why it is like that, and why there are so many lag effect one has to look at from an AUM generation despite higher population in many other states and cities, right? It is purely because what is the level of development, level of per capita of that cities or that states. You look at Mumbai, maybe the per capita would be beyond $3,500-$4,000. Somebody had done that math. I do not have that readily available right away. But if you look at, there are material dichotomy when it comes to what is actual per capita of different cities, different states, and average of different places. And in India, there are many countries. Means one has to look at India is a very, very large market. And there is, means from all these big products of financial services, we have not even scratched surface. When you look at US, mutual fund market is bigger than the deposit market. Whereas in India, it is still at 1/5 or lesser than that. You look at insurance market, it is beyond that. In India, insurance market is still around 1/3 number. Outstanding AUMs or premiums of all the insurance companies put together. Then you look at general insurance in India, we hardly have anyone doing house insurance. We hardly have anyone doing even medical insurance, and a bigger exposure data exposure is very out, that the last 2 years was pandemic, 1.5 years, and you saw more than 2/3 of people getting impacted because of COVID and were hospitalized for whatever reasons, have spent money out of cash, means of their own cash, versus paying through the policies they might have, whether it is group mediclaim insurance or a personal mediclaim insurance. So I'm just saying that we have a very long way to go when it comes to penetration of financial services. Therefore, so comparing who will be winner, whether we will also have similar outcomes in the next 5 years, 7 years, 10 years, I do not think so. Recently, I'd written a blog on our website, which is available on the website. I think we are in still a stage where winner taking it all, or maybe who would be the winner, will be only decided after 5-7 years. And for that, one has to appreciate Reserve Bank of India. Reserve Bank of India is a very hard regulator, ideally. Does not allow a lot of insane competition or a direct competition to the banks. Means there are so many fintech companies in the country. I have met more than 100 fintech companies in the last 1 year, sitting at home doing a WFH or even going to office. We met at least 10-15 companies, even in person, in the last 1.5-2 months. Not all of them are coming for IPO, but I'm just saying that there are so, India is the largest, India has the largest number of fintechs in the world, ideally speaking, and in making. But it doesn't even have 2-3% of companies which are at any size close to US average fintech companies. So there is a lot of data behind that also. I don't want to bore you with that mathematics, actually speaking, but I'm just making a point is that even from a fintech expectation and point of view, we are lagging massively. And I can only tell you is that there is a lot of basically a landscape which is very large. And the good part is a lot of this landscape, because of RBI's regulatory overhaul, is not going to be enjoyed by only outsiders, and the incumbents will face music, which has happened in US. So in India, players like HDFC Bank, say a Bajaj Finance, say SBI through its SBI YONO app, then ICICI Bank have wherewithal or have fighting power or created capabilities which will be able to fight with a lot of these fintech stroke disruptions which we could see in the market in the next maybe 5 to 10 years. Maybe 10 years is too long a period to answer that. So that's your broader answer to your question. Amit bhai, does it answer your thought process?
Thank you very much. It was really interesting and revealing.
Just a conclusion, maybe if what I am thinking is 5 years down the line would be the right period, or maybe 7-8 years down the line would be right period. When you ask me this question again, that
to ponder over the same.
whether we see the banks actually derailing the strength of the banks or maybe so a lot of people have asked, sorry, maybe you have a lot of questions, but I'm just getting a point of view in mind. So I'm talking and trying to keep this maybe more candid and more free flowing. A lot of people have asked me ke 2010 ke pehle US markets mein banks had a very big weight. US stock markets, major indices like Dow Jones or any broader index, if one has to look at, banks had a big weight. And it is now less than 16-17%, the bigger financial services play there. I'm not talking about the fintech guys. I'm not talking about any tech play, because there the tech play has ruled the roost, ideally speaking, whether it is Amazon, Google, or stuff like that. Now, the second point is India will also go through the same thing. That is what people compare or are asking, ideally. So a point I'm trying to make is this is the question I was asked even in 2013 when we launched the fund. In India, banks are not going to, there will be winners which will come outside banking system. So precisely that was our thought process, that we wanted to be a financial services fund, not just only banking fund. But even if you look at from that point to now, banks have actually done really well. And you look at our portfolio, it's been largely balanced between bank, NBFC, insurance, and across the way. And that is how things are going to be even in future. So we, at least me as a fund manager is very well, fund manager and senior analyst is very well versed to think that the change is going to come, point number one. But it is not going to reduce the pie, what is happening globally, but it will only increase the pie of financial services business. And it's then my duty or everyone's duty to find, keep finding that ideas or keep finding that winners, back them. And maybe you can create portfolio outperformance basis that.
Well, I have another 5 questions for you. So I'll start shooting it one by one.
Sure, sure. So, and I am sure that there would be more people also, and people should write in the Q&A box also.
So if you look at the global indices like Dow Jones, for example, financials have a weight of 16%. S&P 500 has a weight of 10.8%. MSCI FE, which is the developed market excluding US and Canada, has a weight of 17%. MSCI emerging market has a weight of 19%. But then when you look at India, the weight of financial in the Nifty 500 is around 30%. That too, we are not including into that, all these insurance and other financial companies. So any particular reason why financials command such a huge representation in Indian market?
So I tried to partly answer this question, Amit bhai. So very clearly, one, our economy is more of 1980s or 90s of US. To my mind, we could have a big growth cycle for the next 10 years. And maybe therefore I am saying that it's the time, maybe after a few years, you should be looking at this question more seriously, that how we see the change even in the market share or market cap movement. Maybe, I don't know if I can, I'm allowed to share a screen, and I'll just want to show up one slide, which could be very interesting to understand. And I keep sharing this slide because it's a simple slide. People like it. People understand. So maybe I'll do the full screen. I'm not showing why I'm bullish on banks. Maybe the next question comes and I'll show you all this data. But what really what Amit bhai is told about, right? And we've tried to capture this. So this is how Indian banks' market caps are. And what US has already been told, I have graphs also for that. In fact, I can show you that also in some time. But I just want to say this, and why therefore you're looking at a complete financial services as a package and a sector. And therefore, as answer lied in the question itself, Amit bhai, that there are so many companies even now, whether it is insurance, because all of them or most of them are $10 billion plus. And whether it is general insurance companies now, which is going to get listed very soon in the next 1 or 2 years time, basically more companies will get listed. The competitors of ICICI Lombard and Star Health, which got recently listed. Then there will be more mutual funds. Today, we heard the news that SBI MF also will get listed in the next few months or years, 1 year's time frame. Also, if you look at our market cap movement as a country, you look at, say, early 90s to early 2000, it was largely driven by the public sector bank. Then came the era of private sector bank. There was always some or the other movement of NBFC And now you look at last 4 or 5 years, there is insurance and maybe some sort of fintech and capital markets companies trying to scratch the surface of overall market cap of financial services sector in India. So in maybe next 10 years time, these things are going to change. Okay. But what I am trying to say is our duty is not just to look at only banks. Our duty is to look at the entire financial services sector. The growth of country is still on a very faster footing. We have a strong regulator who also manages the inflation as well as maybe interest rates fairly well from a country's point of view. And luckily, what we have is a very solid macro today versus many other countries or very at least many other emerging markets. So maybe my simple answer is I think things will keep changing when it comes to financial services sector in India, but weightages may continue to remain high. Because we still have a lot of players on the right hand side of this chart, or you can look at this chart, okay, which is very recent since our fund had launched. And even then, if you look at, there have been definitely a lot of listing. What I am trying to say is, we as a sector, it was rupees 11,000 billion, and now which has gone up more than 5 times, okay. And if you look at broader markets, may not have gone 5 times in the same time. But a lot of this 5 times gone up is also because of new listing and it happens at higher prices. Point I'm trying to say is when you have higher market cap companies and you're comparing a material bigger portion of Nifty 50 or maybe top 100 companies, you would have these market caps looking way bigger and therefore their pie or their share in the exchange broader indices continue to remain strong or high. Does that answer your question?
Yes, sir. I'm going ahead. So when one checks the list of mutual funds, there are more than 10 funds which are investing in the banking and financial services sector. And if you look briefly into them, almost all funds would have 60 to 70% of portfolio overlap. So how would you differentiate Aditya Birla Banking and Financial Services Fund from the rest?
And that's a very interesting question, Amitbhai. So see, our initial thought process to fight with market was that we will be banking and financial services fund. And you have seen, this is a chart which I have not showed in the past, the pie of movement of market cap. I remember people used to ask me question, at least in 2013-14 was, okay, what is your view on public sector bank? Which nobody asks me now. Actually, I have turned very bullish on public sector banks, on a select public sector bank. First time in our history of my fund management and our fund that we are actually overweight on PSU banks. I'm not saying I'm bullish on all public sector banks. I'm only bullish on State Bank of India and Bank of Baroda as such. We have 2-3 stocks only from a public sector point of view. But because their weightages have gone down so much that we are actually looking like an overweight positioning in the fund. Now to answer the question differently or keep telling you again that how you should differentiate Aditya Birla Sun Life Banking and Financial Services Fund versus say a B mutual fund or C mutual fund or a D mutual fund. Would very clearly be looking at our long-term track record of performance. We continue to be a more, most of the funds would be more concentrated because the benchmark are such, we have heavy weightages in bank benchmark, but we've been taking very active calls also regularly. And we've tried to back winners very well. Means in this fund, first time what we would have bought bank Bajaj Finance, right, would have been at 135 odd rupees, like-to-like comparison of today's price. And today it is close to 7,000 odd rupees. Okay. And we've continued holding. In fact, we've only booked gains over a lot of years. And there could be many stocks or thought process, I mean, winner ideas in our fund like that. Now, we've delivered outperformance, we've delivered sector performance, basically. And our thought process is even now, if you look at, say, last 2 years when the markets were fairly volatile. They are still very volatile. And even in the last 6 months when the banking sector has not done well, our portfolio has been more agile or more steady because we have a humongous weightages when it comes to across financial services sector. So insurance as a weightage for my sector fund has been beyond 15% for last 1.5-2 years, whether there were few players listed or more players listed. Then similarly, you look at there is few segments like non-banking companies also have higher weightages, the NBFC sectors. So I can only tell you is that you will get a complete diversified financial services play when you look at Aditya Birla Sun Life AMC. And now it is at least more than 5 years of track record that the fund has largely delivered. And even from since inception of the NFO of our fund, we are actually ranked one, ranked two on a consistent basis, also long term. So that should maybe good enough to answer your question that we are doing very well or we're doing fine.
The BFSI sector in itself is not so homogeneous. There are banks, NBFCs, insurance companies, and other financial services. If one looks further deeply, even NBFCs are not homogeneous in itself. There are home finance companies, gold finance companies, microfinance companies, and the list goes on. So the question is that how does Dhawalgarh as a fund manager view the entire space from an investment point of view? Which segment of the market are you most interested in going forward? And I have a request, personal request, that what is your view on gold financing companies?
Good question again, Amit bhai. So one very clearly, as I said, people keep asking whether what do you think as growth rate? You look at last 5 years when it comes to Indian financial services system and especially the large banks, right? Or overall banking credit has only grown at 6 to 8% CAGR. Okay. And if I have to look at our fund, despite that, right, but that's the top line. And you look at last 5 years, our fund has delivered close to 16-17% CAGR return. It's not very easily possible if your sector outlook itself has not been so great. We have had NPL crisis, we had demonetization, we had GST implementation, late slowdown in economy. Then we had COVID on top of it. So sector has definitely been under a lot of pressure. And it impacts across lending organizations, whether it is gold finance, whether it is housing finance, or whether it is infra, or whether it is consumer lending. So the point is, what we try to do is we try to follow a BMV concept, whether it is Dhawalgarh or many other fund managers at Aditya Birla Sun Life AMC. We have a focus to follow very simple stuff when identifying stock or identifying a company and formatting a view on the company. So we follow concept called BMV, which is business management and valuation. A fund manager could have a different strategy of investing. As a house, largely we follow GARP, which is growth at reasonable price strategy when you are investing. Basically the investment philosophy. There would be few fund managers who are very growth oriented, few could be very value oriented, few could be more price oriented from a perspective that how market, because they are maybe owning multiple sector fund or multi-cap as a strategy, you will have to have different strategies within one fund. If you ask me, Aditya Birla Sun Life Banking Financial Services Fund, largely growth oriented with a GARP as a thought process and try to identify companies which can grow at 15 to 20% compounding for next 5 years. I will not be worried if the sector does 40% return next year and I'll have a lot of stocks which will only deliver 20% return. But if they can give me a confidence and conviction that they can continue to grow at 15-20% for next 5 years, I am very, very happy to own them and continue even if they underperform for a year or two. So that is the broader concept, how this fund is run and what do I think. So for the last few years, I've been telling that we still, and today also I still tell that 15-20% is something if the company can deliver earnings on a consistent basis, we would like them and we would own them. Largely, that's point number one. Available at a reasonable valuations may not be very cheap valuations. Therefore, we never went into public sector banks or many other companies which could be dying or not being very good sector as such. Point number two, what do I like right now? So I like, as I mentioned, I like public sector banks for a change after a long period of time. It is only because the weightages of public sector bank within our financial services indices has reduced to a very low single digit versus they used to be more than 20% in the past. I like ICICI Bank or any retail oriented bank in the country, especially the larger ones and not the mid-size and the smaller ones. So if you look at our portfolio, we would have heavy weightages on ICICI Bank or an Axis or an HDFC Bank as such. Then I continue to like few NBFC companies which can grow at 15-20% plus. But definitely there are very few companies like that left in country. And therefore, we'll have to keep searching for newer ideas, whether then it is in NBFC companies or insurance, or maybe the fintech world, few which will get listed. So maybe recently we found a couple of names which we introduced in the portfolio, one in the housing finance space and one in maybe a mid-sized NBFC company, which got bought over by a very marquee promoter. Means I do not have any problems in naming the company, but we just saying that there are a few companies which we identified recently, which will build over a period of time. Then I continue to remain bullish on insurance sector, whether it is life insurance and general insurance. So that would be a reasonable portion of my portfolio. And overall basis, continue to try to keep balanced view of 55% of banks and the remaining on non-banking and insurance companies. Now, view on gold finance as a business. Gold finance company, there is a one big company which is called Muthoot Finance. We are fairly bullish or positive on the name, though we do not own the name right now. My view is that this business is not going to grow at 20-25% very easily for the next few years, because what has happened is, say, fintech stroke, most of the other NBFC banking company are very heavily or aggressively looking to do retail loans. So I spoke about loan growth in the system being less than 8% CAGR for last few years. Industrial credit growth, which is corporate and mid-sized corporate credit growth, has been 1% CAGR for last 3-4 years. So a bulk of the loan growth is driven by retail segment. And when we talk about retail, it is mortgages, the home loans and loan against property, as well as a lot of unsecured and personal loan segment. So banks, NBFC, fintech companies are very aggressive. So it's no longer the time when it used to be historically 10 years, 15 years back, that for seeking a loan, somebody will have to either mortgage a property or mortgage a office property, or for that matter, any other fixed asset, or for that matter, gold as a commodity or a security. Now, what I feel is that if at all, gold finance companies would be linked with gold prices also, which we do not have any control over. Last 2 years have been good for gold prices on an average basis, point number one. Point number two, there has been a very low interest rate scenario in the country because of COVID and lower economic activity globally and in India, and global rates being low, which has benefited a lot of NBFC companies. And generally, the yields do not come down so much the way cost of funds come down. So therefore, their margins and ROAs are very high. So we would have to see how growth comes in the gold financing company going forward. And most of these companies are also diversifying out of gold finance into other businesses, which is MFI and how mortgage businesses, which is housing finance. And MFI has done really bad in the last 2 years through time because of the slowdown and because of COVID-related stress. So we'll have to see how these companies do well. But yes, Muthoot Finance is a good business, 18-20% consistent ROE business. We'll have to see if they can consistently deliver 20% plus earnings growth for us to get into this company again in our portfolio.
Sir, there is a lot of dichotomy of views about this sector, BFSI sector. Many MF says that, fund managers say that it's a very fragmented industry. The last 5 years returns are actually they are underperforming even diversified funds. And many marquee fund managers are underweight on the same. And they have done very well by being underweight on the same. Obviously, market is always of the diverse views, and someone is selling, then only someone is buying. So what is your take on this? If I see good fund, many fund managers, I don't want to name them, but they are, if you see their portfolio, even their weightage is less than 10% in banking and finance. Sir, what is your view on this? What is your take on this?
Today, if you ask me, Amit, I'm very, very bullish on the sector and the outcome the sector can give you in the next 3 years. So maybe I'll just share, means you mentioned the point, but looking at the chart, maybe people can look at this and can question me, and your question is seemingly right. You look at the last 1 year and 2 year performance. This is largely two main indices. A lot of our competition fund have Nifty Bank as their as benchmark. And for us, it is Nifty Financial Services Index, which itself outperforms bank. And therefore, we have been like telling you for many years that you should be investing in a more diversified financial services fund. But you look at the last 2-3 years performance versus broader indices, which is Nifty 200, which is Nifty 50 or Nifty 500, as you mentioned, right? And I have also included Nifty 500 because a lot of it is small cap driven, and you have seen how the small cap funds have performed in the last 2 years. But you look at the long-term history and you look at both banking index as well as financial services index generally outperform, and you look at last 10-year data, despite the last 2 years or 3 years being consistently poor versus most of the other indices, still has a material outperformance. My point of view is very simple. We had challenges which is because of corporate asset quality problem. We had challenges of growth, which I have told you that the last 5 years, credit growth has been very low single digit CAGR. Industrial credit growth is not there. And COVID has come. So people have got worried that whether what will happen on the NPL scenario. My point of view is the ROA, ROE for the sector could be reaching decadal height in the next 2 years' time. And therefore, the price performance could be very, very strong. Maybe this is like segment-wise performance within financial services. You talk about fragmented and stuff like that, but I think we need to keep searching for pockets of opportunity, how year-to-date performance has moved. You can look at our fund. We've had a reasonable allocation to PSU banks, and they've done well. And especially largely it is SBI driven. And that is our bigger weightage stock even in our portfolio. Then you look at maybe what I wanted to cover or thought about means that's the question you asked. So what we feel is that the GDP growth will going to exceed very, means grow very well in the next few years. It would be driven by private capex as well as government capex largely through the infrastructure sector. And therefore there could be a turnaround in credit growth in a material manner going forward. The more importantly, what I wanted to cover a point here is Indian financial services, especially the banking sector, are always the price performance is basis the credit cost or NPL formation. And to my mind, we are more like getting into a 2003 to 2007 type of cycle, at least from a NPL performance. So next few years, we will have lower and lower credit costs until unless we have a wave three, which I don't have any handle. But if you do not have wave three, maybe we could have a very strong next 2 to 3 years when it comes to credit cost or NPL formation. And then you can see a lot of price performance, which can come in the larger banks. Today, if I have to look at HDFC Bank or a Kotak Bank or an Axis Bank have largely been flattish in this current calendar year. And we are almost in the middle of December. So we are going to be ending this year very soon unless we have a 15-20% uptick in the next 10-15 days itself. So this is some data I wanted to show you. Look at from the 2003 to point of view of 2021. We are entering a period still at a very high NPL ratios. And it can fall. And a falling rate from here could just get you to the very strong uptick in the earnings. And therefore, I can only tell you is that the time has come for us to invest in this sector.
You already preempted the last question. But then also I'll ask it. How do you see NPA cycle forming up, shaping up from here? And do you see any probability of unwinding of NPA provisions?
Unwinding is not in our numbers. So what happens, you know, generally, Abid bhai, and this is like virtue of my age or virtue of my limited experience, though you guys may think that we have a lot of wisdom or we've seen a lot of cycle. The good part about my experience is I've only seen very dire scenario when it comes to credit cost and credit growth in the country in most of the banks. I am the guy who's seen or been negative on public sector banks since 2012 era to now or last 1 year, I've been bullish. And we've seen decimation of these banks. And you could have seen a lot of corporate related NPLs which comes. And this is cycle, right? A lot of banks have now become risk averse, have now become wary of doing any large ticket loans generally, if it is not government linked or not Birla, Startas or big groups. People will not lend money just like that to maybe the smaller names so easily. The way it used to happen between, say, 2005 to 12 times. Okay. So I would say there is not much of corporate NPL left in the country, ideally. And nobody is there behind trying to push NPLs to next year or forward years and not showed that data very, very clearly. Then basically, point number two, if I have to make this, COVID did play a lot of problem to MSME and retail loans. To my mind, a lot of banks, especially the larger private banks and State Bank of India, have aggressively provided or created buffers for the same. We are not positioned. Price performance is already positioning the wave three in the country. Ideally, that is my personal opinion. But if there is no wave three, nobody material big lockdowns or such type of an event, I think we are done with credit cost cycle. Whatever NPL will come will be coming from an ECLGS type of loans, which were done for the system at large, but it is guaranteed by the government of India. Point number one. So therefore, a lot of it will not be credit cost intensive. It will be more timing intensive. And a lot of other thing which will come would be in general, normal routine NPLs. So what I am trying to say is, from a very high credit cost, you will actually start having 1 or 2 years, which could be F24 or F25, which you will undershoot the credit cost aggressively. That is what we are building in today. If you have recovery years like we had during 2006-07, when you had the complete steel cycle, complete real estate cycle, and therefore all the promoters were able to sell a lot of their land and everything and actually repay debt of old historical debts, we could actually have negligible credit cost or negative credit cost also. But that is something we are not building. So maybe net-net, we are very bullish. I think we are in opportune time for F23-24 banking and financial services, lending sector performance. But we still remain a balanced outlook when it comes to portfolio construction.
So, as you said, Dhaval, that large AUMs are from Mumbai and Delhi. And despite that, I am really thankful to Mickey and Gauravji from the bottom of my heart to give me an opportunity.
Surat is just like Mumbai.
To a small distributor of a small town, I am really thankful. And I think leave this now to Mickey for throwing open the question.
If I talk about Amit Bhai is just modest enough. I think he has got more than 350 crore of asset under management in mutual fund, as well as also he's also having presence into other asset under advisory. Mein unke paas AIF aur unme bhi hai. So he has always been active when it comes to client wealth creation. And today, it shows about his commitment and passion that his health is not well. And I think he was shivering also just one hour back. But he shows that once I have taken, then I'll surely be into the con call. So I think thanks, Amit Bhai. After such odds, you managed to come and also give, even say, ask questions on behalf of all the partners, which is very relevant. Also on various groups also, there has been question, Dhaval Bhai. And Dhaval Bhai, you are known for that taking a preemptive stand. I have been observing you from the day you have joined. I think you are always, as you mentioned about the GARP technique or philosophy, at the same time BMU model. We have been always observing that you are always content about NBFC, that I prefer a more NBFC. And your as you mentioned about the SBI and Bank of Baroda, the quality PSU that you now started taking into the portfolio. So you are always preemptive when it comes to any movement that you are taking in a portfolio. But few questions are coming about that fintech, specifically the Paytm tie-up with that DFC or the Amazon tie-ups with that. So I think there is always so this question has been coming. So because they are expert into data analytics or business analytics compared to the banks, right? So what's your say on that? Because I think Billa has also invested into one of the Paytm. So I think we just want to understand in detail from you if it's possible.
Yeah, very well. I was expecting this question to come from Amit Bhai, actually. Thank you, Amit Bhai, for taking out time and doing such a nice, interesting session. I think you answered a question, asked lot of relevant questions. And I think people's doubts should have been clear, and they should always touch base with Mickey or maybe other colleagues to get back to us. I'm happy to answer a lot of questions. Now, coming to say, I had written a note, maybe a small blog about a 1.5 months back. Mickey Bhai, you can circulate the link on the current Q&A session itself if people wants to read that. Today, there is no real winner to be identified whether banks will win or fintech companies will win. Amit Bhai asked the question whether it will be like US or Western countries where banks have actually lost market share plus lost multiples compared to their history. And therefore, the weightage is in the broader indices. Whether India will go through the same thing. What I am trying to say is India still is a long way away when it comes to penetration of across the board financial services products. And therefore, we'll have to see who comes out of the winner. And in India, because of right regulations, as well as the players like HDFC Bank, ICICI, Axis, State Bank of India, being aggressive and ahead of the curve when it comes to tech play. So, or embracing the tech play. As you mentioned very clearly, ICICI Bank is already having a right partner with Amazon. And you can look at the credit card issuance ICICI Bank has been able to do in the last 2 years, which is a multifold increase for them. You look at the way, say, maybe the credit card business, HDFC Bank had a 30% type of plus market share, which still it is in the spends, despite the RBI not allowing them for the last 8-9 months to issue new cards. But I'm just trying to tell you is that even today, HDFC Bank remains the number one credit card player in the country, both with terms of respect of cards outstanding as well as spends. But a lot of people have done catch up. Similarly, what I'm trying to say is our thesis on Paytm is very simple. If you look at as a house, we've been very bullish across internet, store, tech, stroke, disrupting companies, whether it is Zomato, whether it is Nykaa, whether it is Paytm, whether it is any other tech, a policy bazaar for that matter. So if you have to look at the market opportunity is humongous. And there is no straight or right answer how to value these companies. Now, what we have done is we've tried to understand how global companies are valued and how global companies are trading at whatever multiples. So if you look at, there are successful companies like Square, PayPal, Adyen, and such of them are, most of them are $80 to $100 billion of market cap today. Few of them have seen some price correction in the last few days because of the Fed meeting, which is there tonight. Maybe that could be one of the reasons, or maybe because it is a year end and it's been a good year from a market point of view and there could be some profit booking. But I'm trying to make a bigger point here is that in India, still there are hardly any companies which is beyond $100 billion when it comes to financial services as a sector. Only HDFC Bank is the one which goes beyond that. And whereas now if I have to look at market, 30, 40 crores population of US, entire Europe would be similar overall. And they have market cap companies which are huge. यहाँ पे एक सिंपल क्वेश्चन है, सिंपल आंसर है कि एड्रेसेबल मार्केट साइज इज 135 140 करोड़ पॉपुलेशन, आउट ऑफ विच एटलीस्ट वी हैव फेवरेबल डेमोग्राफी फॉर नेक्स्ट टू डेकेड्स और थ्री डेकेड्स. देयरफॉर आर मार्केट साइज और अपॉर्चुनिटी साइज इज फार बिगर. सो पीपल हु कुड कम एंड बिकम विनर मे टेक टाइम टू गेट आइडेंटिफाइड एज विनर. But what I am trying to say is that we'll have to keep evaluating them in a very different, and definitely we'll have to take a contra, or we'll have to take we'll have to get into them considering evaluation mode, because we don't know whether the banks will come out winner or fintech companies will come out winner in India for India's case basis. But the market is there. The growth is going to come from a BNPL stroke retail loan segment or small ticket lending segment in India. Why Bajaj Finance became Bajaj Finance, right? Despite so many banks and so many NBFCs and so many small finance banks being there, purely because Bajaj Finance was able to do something, or he was able to enhance pie or get into the market new to credit segments. Most of these fintech companies are getting new to the credit segments. They're not going and giving loan to Mickey, Amit, Dhawal, who are already able or eligible for credit card as well as many other types of loans. And they're also getting into loans which are 3 to 5,000 rupees ticket sizes, less than $100 loan. So very clearly, these are something which will need a lot of service, which will need a lot of differentiated technology play, and which will need scale. Today, nobody in fintech is able to give me or show me scale. Maybe Paytm is one of them. Even from a payments industry, right? In India, because of regulation, no one makes money. But Paytm actually makes money, or at least does gross profit when it comes to payments business, at least. I'm not saying it makes profits as such, but it is at least making gross profit in payments business. Nobody else makes and you look at who are big players in payments business in India, apart from banks, and banks have very well clearly stayed away from payments business because payments business don't make money. Google Pay, Phone Pay, Amazon is very small player. Paytm is actually third player. Phone Pay is number one. Number two is Google Pay. Third is Paytm. Fourth is smaller, 1% share is Amazon. And could be WhatsApp, JioPay together could become the new competitor or new challenger to the market. But basically, the market is going to be between these 3 to 4 players or 5 players at best. So ultimately, they would have the highest number of users. Today, Paytm has more than 6 crore monthly active users. And Paytm has a differentiated strategy versus, say, a PhonePe or a Google Pay, at least. And today they've already raised capital. So I do understand market jitteriness that the price has fallen sharply, and because the company doesn't make profit, none of the fintech or tech plays which we are seeing in the markets are actually making any profits apart from Nykaa maybe. So we'll have to live with these type of companies because they are into investing mode and still not in a growth mode as such, which comes with a profit. And globally, most of these tech type of play or payment type of companies have actually been trading at 20 times or higher on price to revenue or 30 times EV to gross profit multiples. So we'll have to see whether we trade in a country like India. Does these companies trade at similar multiples? Today we've tried to value them at the average of these type of multiples. And we see, therefore, we see a reasonable upside in companies you mentioned, or there could be more opportunities, and we look at them very actively. But it will be only maybe a few years down the line we'll be able to tell whether who is winner and who is not winner.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah.
It explains. There is also one question from Rahul Rajji on the, in next 4-5 years, I think smaller payment banks are coming on the same line. He's asking your view on this.
So, payment banks, there are very few payment banks in the country, first thing. As I mentioned, in India, because of regulatory reasons, payment banks don't make money, or payment products don't make money, whoever is doing, right? UPI is free. And now today, last week when monetary policy came, there is a discussion paper that they want to cut MDR charges for even credit card or for wallets or for all these things. Actually, we are going into a free world which may not sustain for very long. Even the Jio type of free data, free phone only sustained for a 2 years time frame, and you're already seeing that it impacted few players, and Jio's ARPU also has not gone up materially as expected. But yes, they have been able to kill other players, and therefore they could be winners in long term, and they have the capital to keep pumping in or keep the pricing very low. Similarly, payments bank, they have been able to do business what the normal banks are not been able to do. But whoever is able to say cross sell and be a financial services distributor player as well, and who is able to consistently make, say, reasonable profits, and because you will not need any risk capital, I think they would come out winners. But it will remain a smaller segment from a market cap point of view, because till the time payment banks convert into a normal universal bank or a small finance bank, which can also lend because of the data they collect for the people they do payment related business, there will not be a big money to be made. But yes, there would be one or two players within this segment which could have a very bright future.
Thanks Dhaval for and thanks Amit bhai for making this session interactive and relevant for all. It will surely help while advising to the partners as well as our team also. So the good part of what Dhaval has mentioned is that as Dhaval is known for that preempting the trend, I think before it reflects into the Excel return what he mentioned, 1 saal, 2 saal, 7 years, I think Birla has been into top 3. Birla Banking has been into that. And he's also known for identifying sector, I think what he did in when he launched the fund. And now he's saying that it's not a best practice, but the next practice, and the next sector would be going ahead would be banking for the reasons what he mentioned. And I urge all the partners to just allocate the sector allocation what you just overall, apart from diversified large cap and mid cap, whenever you are just allocating, I think it's better if we just allocate 10-15% into the next sector, which is going to give returns from here onwards. So Next Alpha is going to create from that, and even with our business cycle fund, among the identified 4-5 sector, banking was among them. So I urge all the partners to just take, and also take care, and while giving allocation, give allocation to our banking BFSI sector. And for any query other than this phone call, you can write to any of us, to all your RMs, branch heads, region heads, and also to Dhaval bhai. And just thank you very much once again to all the partners, and Dhaval bhai and Amit bhai, for making it this session really interesting.
Thank you.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.
Mutual fund निवेश बाजार के जोखिमों के अधीन है. Scheme संबंधी सभी दस्तावेजों को ध्यान से पढ़ें.